Yeah, hello. In this talk, I will obviously tell you about our migration from Jenkins to the GitLab CI. I will give you a more detailed insight how we changed to GitLab at all. So we were previously at Jenkins and GitHub. And yeah, we changed our Git DevOps strategy. And yeah, I tell you why and what we changed, and especially what we learned. So yeah, first of all, I'm Philipp, Westphalen. I'm from Hamburg. I work at adSoul, a small startup out of the other group. And working as a full stack developer, mainly I currently doing DevOps and bug smashing at my company. And yeah, before I joined them in the start of the year, I got deeply in touch with GitLab at my school and fall in love with GitLab and wanted to work with that. And yeah, a part of that, I'm a GitLab hero because I'm organizing the GitLab meetup in Hamburg. So if you are there and one meetup has happened there, you're kindly welcome. So yeah. And aside of that, I'm a hacker school inspirer to bring young people into the software development and teach them at a weekend. So first of all, what are our technical landscape at adSoul? We are mainly developing a Spring Boot application with a Vue Frontend and using a Postgres SQL. We are building previously with Maven as our building tool for our Java applications. We used Jenkins and our own Docker registry in a private cloud, which is maintained by a provider. There's also a Kubernetes cluster we use for our applications. And yeah, source and product management is hosted by GitHub. So what are our challenges? Why we wanted to change our DevOps strategy? So we are a really young startup. We are five developers in our company. So we have literally no time for everything to do. So we need more time for developing our application than focusing on maintenance and our DevOps task. So because we are Jenkins, the building process is a little bit tough to learn because the most of us could not easily read a Jenkins file, and this is really unfortunately when someone is in the vacation. So yeah, and it's an old application, so the old DevOps strategy is a little bit older. yeah, and we figured out our Jenkins is not so stable at all, and it's really tough to change them because it's also managed by our provider. And yeah, we need some speed when we want to change something. And yes, a little bit of me, but the visibility of development status of issues is important to our product management. So it's hard to figure out currently in which state our issue is. So yes. And we are a small development team, so we have to care about costs on our development tools. Yeah. So what, how was our journey to GitLab? I mentioned I got in touch with GitLab before I joined the company. So I wanted really to work with GitLab. So I introduced my colleagues to that. And the first step of all were to gather all information, to asking myself, okay, what could be possible with GitLab? What is, how could it affect our daily work, and what improvements could we achieve with a migration? So I gather all information, and when I thought, okay, I have enough information, I started to get into my colleagues and speak to every specific role where change with GitLab. So yes. I had several feedback loops with every specific role, and then in the end we committed with the whole team to test GitLab at silver status. So we're using the SaaS version of GitLab. And yeah, we said, okay, let's try GitLab out. So we started with a small project first. We gladly had a small project where no pipelines at all, so we had a green field with our DevOps strategy. So we said, okay, before we start, let's think about how we want to build our software. So we really we're deeply thinking, okay, what we need, do we need testing? Yes, of course, it's obviously. So which state of testing we use and we need, and we tried out something new. For example, we used Gradle instead of Maven because it's really more flexible for separate jobs in different environments instead of Maven. Yeah, and we had a we had to find solutions for our private cloud cluster or a private cloud solution by our provider. Because they had security concerns, like how we connect to our Kubernetes cluster to deploy some app from the GitLab shared runner. That was a really big issue. We solved them with providing our own GitLab runner in Kubernetes. So we had to find out this is the right way, because the GitLab runner is talking to GitLab.com and not GitLab.com into our cluster. So we don't have to provide a VPN or SSH tunnel. Yes, and we had some other challenges with our GitLab runner and Kubernetes. I will mention on the next slide. And yeah, we tried out something of the GitLab features, like the Docker registry, because we are running our own or getting our own by our provider. So we tried out the GitLab registry. So what were the challenge with GitLab runners in our Kubernetes cluster? The important thing is caching. We had a lot of dependencies in our applications, so we started with no caching, which only downloads the sources, and we had a stable duration of each step. And we thought, okay, this is not really good for a good duration, so we want to speed up our building time. So we tried out S3 caching by default. And we figured out, okay, it's downloading and uploading the sources. So it literally doubles our duration. And we figured out, or this happened to us, that the upload of the sources could fail. So we had sometimes 30 minutes to wait until the sources are uploaded. And this is not an option for us. And another thing were local caching. So you have persistent volume in your Kubernetes cluster for dependencies, and mount them into your GitLab runners. But our provider were not supportive on that, so we could not use that. But this is maybe the final solution when you are providing a private cluster, and you are. Could not use the AWS or Google solution for caching. Yeah, and notice we are using a private cloud Kubernetes cluster. I think when you are on AWS, you don't have the problems. So in the end, what changed to our technical landscape after the test with the small project? So we moved away from Maven to Gradle because it's more flexible. And in our private cloud, we only use the Kubernetes cluster, where our GitLab runners are working and connected to GitLab, and we use GitLab for every step. So product management, source hosting, and CI, and Docker registry. And this works really good. So we had our small project. So let's move on with the main project. This is a really huge main project, which is a really old application. And we thought, okay, it's really good to do it in three phases. And the first step were, okay, move the repository simply to GitLab and link the Jenkins to the new origin. So we use that. We use the GitHub import by GitLab. It's nearly run smoothly, but we had a really big issue with the migration of our issues and releases and tags, which are not transferred because no reason. We waited every time over a day. Then the job said, okay, he could not migrate our project, but the sources are still there. So it will really confusing, but we found a solution. I will mention on the next slide. So, and the second step of the first phase, where okay, let's modify the scripts to the new origin. We exchange the GitHub API calls with GitLab API. So, this was really easy, and we had a stable build with our new repository, so we could move our project management to GitLab and do not need GitHub anymore. So this is our building step in the old version of our big application. So we had a Git checkout job in Jenkins, which is automatically done by other great tools. Then we had a huge step building and test. And finally, when everything is fine, we deployed to Kubernetes, which could be possible in 5 minutes and sometimes several hours, depending on the customer when there's running a job. So for the problem of the GitHub issue, we created a open source GitHub issue migrator, so everyone can contribute. It's a CLI tool which you easily can configure that you are saying, okay, this is my project from GitHub, let's move it to GitLab. So it's also finds the right owner of the GitHub issue. So it's transferred to the GitLab API, GitLab user, but you have to do the mapping manually, but it's a lot of helping. So yeah, and you can move your releases and tags also. Yeah, you can find it on GitLab. It's not so much perfectly, but when you have the issue, you can use that and help. Yeah, and then we stepped in the second phase where we thought, okay, now we are on GitLab fully with our application, so let's do a lift and shift. So we started to create a GitLab YAML, a CI YAML, and try to simply lift and shift the three steps, but our thought were completely wrong. Process were really far too complex to make an easy lift and shift, because it's where one Docker image which contains everything, and we found out, okay, we need too much time to get this running, and let's skip the phase two and go directly to phase three. Yeah. And a cool pro tip, if you're running your own Kubernetes GitLab runners, increase the log limit if you have to debug your building step, because when you are debugging, you produce a lot of information, and the UI is the only source of your logs, I think so. And the standard size is 4 MB, so this is not enough when you have a really long logging step. Yeah. But it's only possible when you provide your Kubernetes, your GitLab runners by yourself. So we skip to phase three. So we have to, I named the improve of the GitLab, the CI/CD pipeline. So we thought about new ways of building our software. So we split every step in one step, so like the job in the GitLab CI YAML. So, and our idea was, okay, one job does perfectly one thing. So we had that each job is simple and everyone can modify it easily. And we have small environments, so we don't have to build our Docker images on our own. And this is an example from our small project pipeline. So, yes. Which I mentioned, especially in the third phase, we moved then to Gradle. We tried previously one with Maven, but we use Gradle. It's more fits to into our new DevOps strategy. So, it's also improved our building time a little bit. And it's way more flexible, and everyone knows how to use Gradle instead of XMLs. So, yeah. And we tried out parallel job processing, so like our unit tests and integration tests are running at the same time, so we reduced some building time there. And yeah, and a huge impact were the that we are using standard Docker images, so we don't have to maintain the Docker images by ourselves. And yeah, this is far less time for maintenance needed to change the GitLab CI. Yeah, and mostly the official Docker images fits our requirements, so we don't need have the need for a specific Docker image. So, what are our key learnings? What are our key learnings for migration? So one of the biggest issue is to plan your migration really detailed. It could help really in the beginning to get every member of your team to know what's happened when we migrate to GitLab, like what changes to the product management in case of, okay, this works in GitHub, and now this is different to GitLab. And yeah, plan your migration well, and especially take your time for the migration. It's not, okay, we need 2 days and then we are finished. Take your migration and especially do it step by step. So because we are using the three-phase plan, we are able every time to deploy a new version and continue to work on our project. So we could improve our application without to wait for the better infrastructure. So, and yeah, when you have time for your migration, use it for rethinking your completely DevOps strategy. So when you are, use the time for try something out new and maybe, okay, let's do more security issues or automated security, which is really important. And yeah, use it for rethinking your DevOps strategy. And yes. And yeah, when you have the possibility, start with a small project, especially with your colleagues, so spend like an evening or something more to do it together, and that everyone knows what's happened when they are using a GitLab CI YAML. Yeah, and another pro tip, keep your pipeline user-friendly. So we used a lot of comments to structure our config, so we have a good overview. And it's really, really nice to have a good user experience in your CI. So you see everything on one side, and especially comment your variables if you're using them. So sometimes it's not really clear why or what for what purpose the variable is. So, yeah. And in the end, why GitLab suits us perfectly as a small company and tech team. So the important thing is the powerful CI/CD solution. It's really customizable. Oh shit. customizability. You know the word, so it's really to have every project on their own and don't have dependencies to other projects. But with one one example which is useful for sharing dependencies is when you are having a step in every project is the same. Yeah, build a template and use it for every project, like the build step or something else. And yeah, the CI provides us a really low maintenance time. So normally we don't have to care about our CI in a month or more time. But not when Docker changes their security images or the way how they using Docker and Docker. And it's one home for everything, so everyone knows where to find the information. And yes, especially the product management knows what's happened. There's everything visible and you know it afterwards. And yes, the user experience, this is my opinion, the user experience is perfect. I love it more than clicking two different tabs because different tools. And yeah, and our maintenance is really low. So we can keep focusing on building our product instead of struggling with our own infrastructure. So thanks for your attention. And if you have questions, just ask.
Okay, questions, thank you. Hi, what are the main benefits of using GitLab Runners over Jenkins?
It's really easy. You don't have dependency between branches. So if you're trying something out new in for your CI, you can do it simply in a branch, and your master branch will not be affected of the changes. So this is really cool, and the CI YAML is really easy to read. You don't have the big groovy script, and yeah, you can. It's more easier. That's my opinion. So, and you have the documentation everywhere, and don't have plugins. Yes.
Other questions? Oh, very good.
Can you tell me a bit more about your Maven to Gradle migration? Because I know Maven kind of likes to own everything and do the build, the test, the integration test. If you use Fabricate to build the Docker files and everything, and splitting it all up seems like it might be quite hard work to get your head around.
Yes. With Maven, we had it were really complicated to run a task, only one task. For example, only the unit tests. Or only the integration test, you have a really strong configuration effort to achieve that. And with Gradle, you can simply say, okay, this task runs this task, and it's only run the test and integration test, for example. So you don't have to do the steps before. I don't know what. I don't know what. I have no clue.
Maybe better
we
after.
We can talk afterward.
Do that as a follow-on, perhaps. Any other questions? No? Awesome. Well, Philipp, thank you so much.
Thank you.